And the handouts for this class is super, super important. That's like the whole reason you're here. So I have somebody going to get those handouts for you. Let me just start a quick introduction. My name is Luisa Ranson. I am a pastor's wife. My husband is Chris Ranson, and he is a youth pastor here at the Winchester campus. So I have the pleasure and the opportunity to serve alongside of him with the teenagers here of this church. So I'm also a registered nurse. I enjoy being a nurse. That, to me, is one of my callings as well. I often say that my nursing career pays for my ministry life. So I'm thankful for that. I have Miss Donna. Why are you late for class, sister? You know. Miss Donna works with the teenagers too, so I had to give her a shout out there. And I have two boys. One's 13, pray for me. And the other is 4. And
I think it's 13.
Oh, I was just going to say, the 4-year-old prayed and fast for me. So thank you for that word of encouragement. Thank you so much. Come on in. We have been, all y'all mess with my name, and you sit, come front. Oh, you girls are like, they're the party animals right here. All right, come on in. We're going to have some more coffees. I can go over, and that's okay. It'll be food for us later. That's okay. I'm going to have everybody come in. She is, right? That makes you stand up tall and straight. I apologize. I ran out of copies, but they are coming. So by the time you need them in this session, we will have them here for you. So, again, my name is Luisa. I'm a pastor's wife. My husband is a youth pastor here at this church. I was just sharing with the ladies that I'm also a nurse by trade and a mom of 2 boys. So I am so thankful for a church who has these women conferences and allows us. Come on in if you're coming. Find me your gift. I found a gift. Come on in if you want it. I'm thankful for this church who does these women conferences every year. One of the things I'm thankful for is the fact that we get time away from our everyday lives. I know you ladies are busy, so I'm really honored that you're taking time to come. I pray that I have something fresh and new to share with you, or at least I pray that the Holy Spirit will stir up something within you today that only He can do, that He can speak through you. I just want to value your time. I know you're busy. You could have stayed home and did grocery shopping and laundry. So this is your time. I want you all to get something out of this day. You don't have your children around. You don't have your husbands around. You don't have your schoolwork with you, your boss. Bless the Lord. Unless you brought your boss with you. Don't come. Okay. All right. So this breakout session is about finding your gift. Now that topic is a hot topic in the Christian world. A lot of people are wondering, what am I gifted at? Everybody talks about that. You ever notice that? Like, well, the super spiritual people are like, I'm gifted at this. I can't even tell a word to my son without him rolling my eyes at me. Like, really? And so you kind of feel like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. And so this topic has been talked about in churches. It's been written about. Many books have been written about it. Because we all know we're created by God, and we all know we're created with a purpose. But did you know that the scripture says that you not only were created with a purpose, but God has given you a gift? A gift. So what is it? How do we find that? So real quick, and I'm going to abbreviate this because I went over last time, is why do we need to find out our gift? What's so big about it? What's so important? And I tell you what, ladies, many of us are really good at doing a lot of things. And we are in this activity, and we're involved over here, and we're involved over here, and we find ourselves running ragged, okay? We find ourselves living lives of very busyness and very exhausting lives, right? And we find ourselves to be busy, but we have no purpose. So this is why it's important to understand how you are wired, how you were designed, how God has gifted you, so that you can take that gift and that you can be part of His story, and that you can find purpose and definition in your life. Because let's face it, us women, we are just that good. I mean, think about it. God made us to help who? Men! Is that yes, you all can do a lot of things, but does God want you to do all that you are involved in? Is that what He's calling you to do? There has to be a specific purpose or plan, and it's seasonal, okay? When I was in my 20s, that was God's plan and purpose for me then and there. But when I get into my 50s or 60s, I'm not telling you how old I am. When I get there, God's going to have a purpose and plan for me for that season. So what does it look like for us now? What does it look like for us right now? What I want to do is I want to open in prayer and just have the Lord speak to us. Father God, we humbly come before You. We open our hearts to You and slow ourselves down. Lord, we often go ahead of You. We often work out our own desires and our own plans. We often want to make our own paths instead of letting You direct our paths. So Holy Spirit, today I ask that You search us, that You know our anxious thoughts. We know that Your ways are higher than our ways, and we want a part of that higher path that You have for us. Father, we surrender to You right now. We pause in Your presence, asking You, the gift giver, to show us what You have in store for our individual lives as women. We seek You first in Your kingdom. Show us the gift. For the gifts that You have given us, and allow us opportunities to use them for Your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The second question I want to answer, and I want to answer by scripture, is who gets these gifts? Who possesses this? And 1 Peter 4:10 says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. As each has received a gift. So, the Bible, I'm going to sum it up for you. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, that's the first thing that we need to do, is surrender ourselves to His plan and His direction. And when you do that, rest assured that the Bible is true. It's yes and amen. And it's saying that He has given you a gift. It says it in 1 Peter 4:10. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. And that's the why question I want to answer, is why do we get gifts? It's not for our own personal gain. Even though you may think, you know, I believe the Lord can bless you with your gifting. I believe that as you serve Him and seek Him and you do the purpose that He's created to do, blessings will come down upon you. It is biblical. However, rest being sure that the sole purpose of your gift is to bring glory to God. It is to serve and to serve one another. To serve who? His creation. A lot of people think, well, it's just for the church. It is for the church. It is. Our giftings, we should be bringing it, y'all should be bringing it back to your church and your area of worship. But it's also used to bring others to Christ. It is. You know, we need to remember that the church is not this building. We are the church. So when you leave and I say it's to you, bring glory to God and increase the church, that's increasing in you and what you're going to do with that coworker who just lost her husband, that coworker whose child is hooked on drugs. How are you gifted to reach that person? What is your purpose in that particular setting that God has placed you right now? So, I got three tips about reaching or how to find your gifts. We're going to go right into it. And I hope Stacy's running in with my copy soon, because I am doing a little bit abbreviated because I want to really get to the meat of things. Y'all came in here to find your purpose. Y'all got to leave with finding your purpose and your gift. This is great pressure on me. I'm like, let's go to Walter Ray. I got to go. And my first tip for you, my first tip is to pray. Oh, here she goes. That church person talking about prayer. Yes. Ladies, prayer is powerful. Prayer moves the hand of God. Prayer will bring clarity to a bogged down, stressed, overworked mind. Prayer gives you peace in the midst of storms, in the midst of struggles. It gives you peace in situations that you can't even understand. So yeah, Prayer is powerful. It says in Psalms something that I can't find in my notes right now. Psalms 5, verse 3. It says that in the morning, O Lord, you hear my voice. And in the morning, I lay my request before you. I pray. I wait with expectation. Ladies, Elijah, he prayed for rain and it rained. Gideon, he prayed that God will answer him by using a fleece, and guess what? He did. God answered. The Bible says in James 4, verse 2, it says, you have not, because y'all didn't ask God. You didn't ask. Okay? And God says, if any of you lack wisdom, that's everybody. Everybody lacks wisdom. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously without finding fault, and it will be given to you. So yeah. Prayer is my number one tip. It is my one tip. I need you guys to take this as your first action plan. It's no different with any other topic, finding your gifts, praying for a lost loved one, praying for healing, prayer. That is what stirs up something within you that you can't even explain in words. And I guarantee you that as you seek the Lord through prayer, he is going to open up your spiritual eyes. He's going to ignite something within you, whether it was kind of settled down and you knew about it, and you've been like, oh God, that's not it. You don't want me to do that. It's going to come alive. It's going to well up inside of you like, bam, I know what I need to do now. Because I met God and I spoke to him. My second tip is to pay attention. Pay attention. If you ladies have not received your packet, just quickly raise your hand. We have some workers that are going to come through, give you some. And I'm going to just keep on moving. So the next tip is pay attention. Notice the things that energize you. Notice the things that energize you. What gets you excited? What motivates you? Pay attention to those things. What comes natural for you? What comes naturally to you? Okay? The other thing is, what would you do if it were free? What would you do for free in your life? What would you do for free? Pay attention to these questions. So the second tip is to pay attention. Pay attention to how God has created you, what comes natural for you. Pay attention to what other people say about you. Now, I'm not talking about the haters, because the haters are going to hate. That's a quote from Taylor Swift, if you ever needed to know that. I'm not talking about the haters. I'm talking about the people that God strategically placed on your life that's going to say, your house, man. It's so nice here. I'm just so relaxed. I feel like you may have the gift of hospitality, and the church needs that. Or, you know, you may have the gift of financial stewardship. You're just good with money. You're able to give people advice. And that is your gifting. And so pay attention to what you're good at. For example, if this was a small group of women, which it is, and a woman came into our small group prayer circle, and she says, I just lost my job, okay? And this lady comes in, and think about how you would react. If someone just came in and just lost a job, and you know that woman, and you're like, oh, you're so upset. Someone with the gift of shepherding, and we're going to go into that, because you're going to have the list in front of you if you don't already have it. Someone with the gift of shepherding will immediately be concerned about that person's spiritual welfare. Like, oh man, she lost her job. I wonder if her faith is shaken right now. I need to make sure that she is still right with the Lord, you know, and that she is still growing in Christ during this circumstance, this hard time. Someone with the gift of intercession through prayer, someone with the gift of intercession, they're going to walk into the room and hear that they lost her job. Oh, we got to pray. We got to pray right now. Not only today, but we got to pray the next day. We need to fast, and I'm going to pray until God brings the miracle, until God brings the breakthrough. That's how her gifting is. Someone with the gift of leadership, which I know many of us women probably possess, not the way God created us. Someone with the gift of leadership is going to see and hear that same woman say she lost her job, and all of a sudden you're thinking, okay, this is going to be her. Okay, I know this person's hiring that person. Let me make some phone calls for you. And you're just wired to want to just go and meet that need. Now, is one gift better than the other? Is the one who's an intercessor super spiritual more so than the one who is a leadership? No, because they're all given by God, these gifts, and they're all given for a purpose. So pay attention to yourselves and what others have said. And tip number three is try it out. Once you've gathered enough information to create a list of some possible gifts, exercise your gifts. Find an opportunity to volunteer, whether it's in the community or even a better place to start is at your own local church. If you think you have the gift of discipleship or teaching, or you're really good with numbers, financial stewardship, or you really have a desire to work with homeless or the needy, start somewhere local that you can see, is this really what God wants me? Is this, do I get motivated by this? So those are three tips that I wanted to share. And I could say, okay, that's it, we're done. But I know that many of us need more than just that. Many of us need something, and I hope that the tools that you have in front of you, the assessment test, is something that is going to help you get an idea of how you are wired and how God possibly has put a gift in you. All right, so as those forms go around, so I apologize. I made a lot, but they all left. So that's a good thing. I'm just going to keep talking because you guys can catch up when you get your form. All right. So if you're anything like me, I need something tangible. I want something that I'm going to circle, and I'm like, oh, look, this is what I'm gifted at. So, yeah, that's me. I'm going to put it in the refrigerator. That's who I am. That's how God's wired me. And so I like these assessment tools. I want you to know that the one that I gave you came from an author, Bruce Bugbee. And he wrote this book, which is a great book, and I'll have it up here if anybody wants to look at it. What you do best in the body of Christ. And he talks about your purpose, your passion, how you're wired, and what you can do. There's other resources in the back also on books that help you find your gifting and your purpose in life. So this assessment test that I'm giving you, you're going to take home because you don't have time to do today. There's a lot of questions on it. And I promise you, is there staple? Are they staple or no? No? Okay. They're not staple. All right. So let's just start with those who have this. Your servant profile. Your servant profile. Many of you have this. It's behind a sheet. Yep, it's right behind there. You got it? Okay. That is something that I want you to fill out. You're going to fill out some of it right now, but most of this is going to have to be done when you get back home or by a place. So you can really pray and contemplate and see where God is leading you to. And the first thing is the first thing of this servant profile is comprised of three areas: your spiritual gift, your personal style, and your passion. Now it says ministry passion. Some people get tripped up with that ministry. Like, I'm not called a ministry, I'm the pastor's wife. Don't do that to me. I'm not gonna do this for full time. What are you talking about? Guess what? If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, God has given you what's called the Great Commission to go out and to make disciples of all men. Okay, it's no longer the job of just the pastors, but it's all of us. So congratulations, y'all just found your first purpose, your first gift. You're all ministry. You're all in ministry full time because that is our calling here in life. So if you ever wonder, well, what am I supposed to do? First and foremost, surrender to the Lord. That is our first act of obedience to Him. And share the good news to others who need to hear it. So your passion, we're going to be talking about that. Because we do not have time to do the spiritual gift assessment, I just want to highlight your packets in front of you. You have what's called a spiritual, and you took my that one. Spiritual assessment. There you go. Just holding it up. A lot of questions, but don't get tripped up. When you look at your packet, there's like three or four pages of questions. There's one page that shows like a grid and little boxes, okay? And we still have some women who need one. There's a grid of boxes. You will answer those questions honestly. Answer it based on who you are now. So when you take this quiz, answer it based on who you are now. Don't answer it based on who you think you should be or who you want to be. But be honest with yourself because that's how you'll get a good assessment. It's just a tool, okay? It's just a tool that someone created. Many churches use this exact tool. I took the test too for our ministerial licensing. And it just helps you see where this guy maybe moving towards, or maybe there's a gift in me that I didn't recognize. I couldn't even put a name to it. And once you, one packet also, sorry, I lost my, is there one left? Once you add up all of your columns, you're going to add them up going downwards, okay? Going downwards, and then you're going to circle your highest number. And that will give you your three top spiritual gifts. All right, now this topic of finding your gift, I can spend weeks on. Because honestly, if we did a true Bible study, I should be able to, I'm going to just take this from you here, I should be able to show you in the Bible where these gifts are found and how the Bible supports them. Because I don't want you leaving this room thinking, oh, that Chica, Luisa, she told me that this is where I'm gifted. That's just her assessment of it. No, it's not. This is all biblical. And I apologize, we don't have time to go through it all. But take my word that this has been studied and approved. And it is biblical. We are all gifted somehow. And so someone came up with this list of giftedness from the Bible, and it will help you determine what your top three are. One of the ones that I like is the gift of help. Maybe you find yourself to be that person that you hear that single mom just had a baby, and the first thing you're inclined to, and you do it. Nobody has to tell you. You're like, well, I need to make sure I prepare meals. And I need to tell her, hey, when you bring your child to daycare, if you need an emergency contact, I can be that because I don't work on these days, so I can help you. And so all of a sudden, or you walk into a room, how many ladies can walk into the room and right away you can see the need? They're like, there's not enough chairs. I gotta go get chairs. Okay. I got it. And some of us were like, okay, but maybe you're not gifted that way. And there's nothing wrong with that. My husband does not have the giftedness of seeing the need in the house. But he knows what's needed to get done in the body of Christ. So, just pray for him. All right, so I am staying here all day. And during lunch, I'm going to make myself available to go and see how you all are doing with your spiritual gift assessment test. I do want to encourage you that once you do it and you look at the key, you know, find me on Facebook, send me a private message, let me know at lunch if you had the time, the quiet time to do it. Tell me what you're gifted in because I want to help connect you with opportunities that will help you develop that gift. So you can thrive. I don't want you to be women busy without purpose, right? That's not what we want. That's not what the Lord has for us. So let's move on to something that we can do here, and that's called personal style. Personal style. And so you have in your hand that pen, that bullseye target, and you can see personal style is driven. Personal style sometimes referred to as your personality or your temperament. Oh, bless the Lord. All right, and it describes your most natural way of relating with other people. You've heard of introverts and extroverts, right? Where all my introverts at? Oh, they will say anything. There are some kind of activities that give you energy, like, yeah, you know, I'm a youth pastor, so I want to go with teenagers, you know, we're the teenagers, that I feel comfortable, I feel energized, that's what I want to do. And there are other activities that can suck the energy right out of you. For me, it's laundry. Laundry, nothing spiritual, you know, we should burn all our clothes and start fresh every week. It doesn't do it for me. So, do you find interaction with people to be energy producing, or do you find that you get excited and more energetic when you are completing a task? For instance, you know that your task is, I need to send these letters out, and I need to purchase airplane tickets for this team, and I gotta do this. And then once you do all those tasks, you're like, man, I'm awesome and all that. Yes. And you're like so energetic because you did it. You can point, see what I did? I did all that. Or are you that type of person that's like, oh man, I was with a group of ladies and we were just all talking and we went to the lawn and I met this guy in the street and we were just talking. And I just, you get energy from being with people. Okay, so in order to find out our personal style, so we can fill in at least the personal style part of it, we're going to do the spiritual gifts on our own. We need to find out, we need to answer two questions. How are you organized? And how are you energized? How are you energized and how are you organized? How do you like to be organized? Are you a structured lady or are you an unstructured lady? All right, are you more comfortable when you just go with the flow, play by ear?
Yeah.
Three bird. You know those things, walk into work and you're like, she's not gonna last not even 3 months here. That's how I know her. I'm not like that at church, but at work I'm like, come on, stay focused. You know, this is no joke here, don't be laughing. Or are you someone that you need to have a plan, you need to have a checklist, you need to have closure before you move on to something else? You just need to get the work done. You need to work the plan. I'm a nurse. I like algorithms. It tells you where to go to next, right? You know, this person's not breathing, they're dead. Okay, I'm on the board. So that's work, right? That's in that area of my life. In ministry, my husband loves this about me, and I'm saying it sarcastically, I can change it up right now. Be like, okay, no, or new topic, got it. This is what we're gonna do. He's gonna be like, whoo, no, you can't do that. So I have a quick illustration I'm gonna show you that you guys are gonna do. So you just put your papers down on your lap. You don't need to put them anywhere, just on your lap, and I want you to cross your arms. Just fold your arms, cross your arms. And then look at the way you've crossed your arms. And then I want you just look at the way, memorize, okay. Now bring your arms down and then reverse them. Cross them the opposite way. Oh, I usually hold my boot like on this side. Doesn't mean that bow will come natural. There's some parts of us that just come natural. So you can be a woman that can be structured in the moment, and then something changes and you can be unstructured. And if you're a mom, you're unstructured until the day they move out of the house. Just to get embrace that was from God. All right, so, you know what I mean? So just know that even though you can do both, it doesn't mean that one is more natural. So that's what we're talking about. What comes more natural? How is this assessment in front of you? I like this. This is fun. What's it all about you? Answer honestly. And you can do this now. It's very quick.
You don't have your
mind. It says, how are you energized?
Do we not have that?
Oh, I like this. So it's on the back of this. Oh, yeah. All right, so the first question, I'm not going to read through it all day, but I'm going to give you an example. I am more comfortable doing things for people. You can be number one. The closest to doing things for people, that's like number one. And you're like, I'm not that good at being, you know, doing things for people. I like being with people. Remember, the operative word here is doing things for people or being with people. And so it's a continuum. It's 1 through 5. And wherever you are closest to that sign, you would circle that number. When doing a task, I tend to focus on the goal. All right? That's my husband. Focus on the goal. Get it done, right? Or do I focus on relationships? Or maybe you're like, well, I'm a 3. I don't know. I like both. I need to both, right? So that's how that goes. And the first one is, how are you energized? 7 easy questions. Don't overthink it, ladies, which we all do, but you just, you know, write them down, and then you get a total for that. And the second section is, how are you organized? I believe there's 7 questions for that. And so I'll be quiet for 30 seconds. That's the longest I can stay quiet. You guys can think a little bit. And then we'll move on to our passion. I never did this before. I don't know what I am. I don't want to know. This, what if it like rocks my world? Like, oh, sorry, Chris, I can't help you with youth anymore. I'm not a youth person. But I will do this later on with my family. I like to see how they're structured and how they're organized and energized. So that right there is your personal style. And once you know your personal style, you're either going to be someone who is energized by tasks, you like to complete things, you're like a listener, you're like, man, I can organize that event for you. Or you may be wired that you just really perverted people. And this is important because if God has called you to a homeless ministry, right, and you want to work, you know, you're not homeless, I'm going to deal with the homeless, okay. But you are someone that's energized through tasks, but the leader of that homeless ministry puts you in charge of the people and caring for them and speaking to them and this and that, you're going to find yourself drained very easily. You're going to go home drained. I'm like, why am I not energized? Why am I not feeling it? I know I'm doing what God's calling me to do, but because you weren't matched to your personality style. You weren't matched to your gifting. You rather be the one that says, hey, I'm going to call all the volunteers. Yeah, I got the menu for all the meals for the month of March. I know who's cooking it and when they're serving it. I got the itinerary up. I got all of that. I know, oh, yeah, Costco, they're donating the bread. I already spoke to them. That's going to be delivered on Tuesday. That is your gifting, that task. And then you can sit back and see all of these people being served, and you're energized because you know the Lord used you to do that. So it's important to know how you are designed and wired by God. So you can continue doing that. I'm going to move on to the last part of this bullseye, and that is your passion. What's your passion? What's your passion? There are things we all care about, ladies. We care about a lot of stuff, right? And you may care about a topic, but may be passionate about something completely different. Okay, just because you care about something doesn't mean you're passionate about that thing. All right? So, for instance, while someone may really have a heart for the homeless, they feel sad for them, they're bothered by that, they have compassion for the homeless, they may be passionate about something else, so it leads them to a different direction in their lives to serve somewhere else. All right, have you ever met someone who believes that the youth, the teenagers, are the most important people to reach? I mean, they go on and on how they have to go to Winterfest, and they have to be here on Wednesday, and I know you want to give to the Reach Student Ministry because that is the most important ministry there is, and they're vital, and you find me going on and on. That is my passion. And even though you may sit here and you may like or understand the challenges of being a youth leader, and you may feel bad for the people that are homeless, your passion and what you want everybody to wrap their minds and rally is for the right to life, right? That's your thing. You're like, I'm all about right to life. I'm about protecting the babies. I'm about women's rights. I'm about the refugees, and that you're passionate about that. It doesn't mean you're a bad person just because you're not passionate about the things that I'm passionate about. And I'm not a bad person because I'm not passionate about what you're passionate about. The reason why this works and it's good that we have all different passions given to us by the Lord is because we're many people and we can meet the needs of many people. If all of us were here and we only advocated for teenagers, then what's going to happen with our main population in the church, the senior citizens, the single moms, the children's first through K, you know, first through kindergarten. See, we need to all own our own passions and move forth as God has given us discernment and leading. All right, so take out your notebooks. This is the part that's going to be a little self-introspective. You want to take out your notebooks because what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask some questions. And I hope that you can answer them privately in your notebook. Some of these questions, you'll know the answer right away. Some of them, you're thinking, I don't know, God, are you calling me to that? Is that what I'm really supposed to be doing? Is that my passion? Is that my gifting? Again, we cannot even begin to scratch the surface without taking weeks of meeting together and praying together and really asking the Lord to open our spiritual eyes for understanding and clarity in our own lives, in your life, so that you know how you should be operating every day for the glory of God. But for starters, we're going to be talking about passion here. Now I want you to write down answers as they come to you. You know, what do you care about the most? Some of you may be able to answer that right off the bat, like, I know my passion. I already know my passion. Where would you like to see your life make a difference? Where would you like to see your life make a difference, that you actually make a difference? Where would that area look like? Here's another question. Me and you meet for the first time, and we're talking, and we're having coffee, and we're talking, and all of a sudden, you take over the conversation, we change topics, and you're telling me about this topic, and you're talking, your voice is higher, and you're speaking faster, and you're animated with your arms like I am, and you're leaning forward, and whatever you're talking about, you can probably stay up late into the night talking about it. It just does something for you. What would we be talking about? What is it that we would be talking about? I got ideas, but I don't want to give you my ideas. Oh, yeah, that's what we're talking about. Oh, yeah, that's right. No, because I believe the Holy Spirit is present where two or more people are gathered in His name. And I believe that He is able to give you that God-given passion, that God-given desire. So what are we talking about? That's something that would cause you to jump out of bed every morning. What is it? Or maybe you're dreaming. Maybe you're a dreamer. I'm not talking about your falling asleep in this class or your dreaming. I'm talking about God is giving you dreams, daydreams. You know, you're daydreaming. You're reflecting on His goodness. You're reflecting on desires of your heart. All right, the Bible says that the desires of the heart, if you're pure and good, they come from the Lord, right? And so you're visualizing yourself, and as you're thinking about some topic, whatever it is, there's an emotional energy. There's an emotional cord that's pulled in your heart. What if I can do this? And it's this emotional tug in your heart. What is it? What comes to mind right now as I'm saying these words? What is it that you think about when you're alone and you're wondering, what if I could do that? What is it? Or maybe you have a list of achievements in your life. And I encourage you that if you can answer this question, what are your greatest achievements so far in your life? But make sure you write down achievements that you enjoy doing. For instance, we've all been through education. We've all graduated, right? High school. You ask one teenager, was that enjoyable? No, that wasn't enjoyable. So, but that's still an achievement, right? Don't despise the small beginnings, the Bible says. There's something, if there's a seed of something in you, Listen, this is how you can know that it could be your passion, because someone is telling me, sure, you can't do that. What are you talking about? Who is telling you, whether it's the enemy and I don't get super spiritual, or if it's an actual person that's like, honey, you're too old. What are you talking about? They want someone pretty young and toothpick. You can't do that. What is that? Write that down. Don't let your thoughts, don't let your passions or what was birthed in you at 12, 13, 15, 18, 22 in college, don't let that vision die just because you heard someone tell you 5 years ago, you can't do that. Because you missed it then. You're going to always be busy here and there. You're going to be busy without purpose. And you're going to drain yourself. Because nothing, you're going to get to retirement, you're going to sit back and say, what in the world did I do with my time? And I don't want that for you. Whatever your passion is, ladies, it has to pass two tests. Does it glorify God? That means does it bring attention to God, right? And does it edify others? Is it going to help others? So does your passion, the Bible says when you abide in Jesus, He abides in you. So when you go to prayer and you are abiding in the Lord, and you're praying, you're reading your Bible, you're going to church, and you're going to work and you're doing your thing, and, you know, you're trying to keep yourself in right standing with the Holy Spirit of the Lord. You are abiding in Him. Some of you have already gone to prayer and God has already pricked in your heart something that you know He wants you to do. What is it? What desire did He put in you? What desire did He put in you that He's telling you you can do with His strength? Passion. Passion. Now that's a personal thing that you have to work out daily with the Lord. Here's another question I want to ask you. What comes easy to you but difficult for others? What comes easy for you but difficult for others? Where has God strategically placed you right now that only you can accomplish something? I'm not saying that I can't do what you're doing. It's just God didn't place me in that situation. God didn't put me next to that neighbor who needs alcohol and drug rehabilitation. God didn't put me next to that foster mom who's, you know, has three kids, but you're a single woman and you're thinking, I can help her. What does she need from me? I'm not in that situation. So where has God placed you that you can do that no one else can do right now in that season? So that can point you to a God-given purpose. That can point you to a God-given direction and gifting in your life. Again, these questions are just for you to answer and think, because the Holy Spirit will answer you and give you. Another thing is, what frustrates you? Don't tell me your husband, because that's another class. Y'all dismissed it. It was a marriage class. What frustrates you? Because sometimes what frustrates you is going to motivate you to do something. So don't discount those frustrations. Now, I'm not talking about, oh yeah, I'm going to do something. I'm going to go complain to the pastor's wife. Oh no, no.
Keep telling going to the wrong class. I'm going to tell you that.
But what frustrates you? I know that before, I'm a foster mom right now, and I tell you, I never thought I would want to go to the government, to my state representative, nothing. Nothing. I have been Googling my reps. I want to know who I need to talk to, who's going to listen to this case, because I got this fire burning because I'm so frustrated with the system. And God bless those people who work day in and day out. They deserve better. Those caseworkers, I understand. But something's got to be done. So my frustration is, I'm not trying to complain. I'm just saying, who's going to hear me and what can we do? Okay, passion. Passion. And God's given you that. And so listen, a lot of times we get caught up, well, is this passion for the church? You know, I'm not teaching Sunday school. Honey, again, remember, you are all in ministry, wherever God has placed you, to use your gift and your passion in your setting that you're in. Do not lose that, because there are people dying and going to hell and don't know anyone because they haven't come into our church yet to save them. But you all are out there. So use your gift. Use your spiritual gift. Use your passion to reach those people. So now what? Now that you eventually will do that spiritual assessment, and you'll know your top three gifts, hit me up on Facebook, let me know what they are, let me know during lunch if you do it. You know what energizes you, you know how you're organized, you possibly wrote down maybe some things that God is prompting on your heart about your passion. What do you do with all this information? What do you do with all this? This is a lot I'm throwing at you. Again, I can't stress the importance of praying through this and all the things that you have, over the ideas that you have written. The scripture is clear that God gives us the gifts, but it's our job to pray and seek Him, and He will make the gift apparent to us. And so after you've prayed and you ask the Lord, you know, what should you be doing? Ask yourself these questions. Ask the where questions. The where. If you have a passion for children, where should you be serving? If you have a passion for discipleship, where should you be serving? If your passion is for world hunger, where should you be serving? Maybe you've been thinking, man, single moms, I don't know, they're all around and nobody's really doing anything. I don't see them doing something. Again, you frustrated by something, God could be calling you to start a ministry. Okay, you do not need a title, you just need a word. You need confirmation from the Lord, you need spiritual leaders over you. Of course, we want to do things in orderly fashion, right? We just don't want to be loosey-goosey with the things of God. But could it be singles ministry? I mean, single moms ministry or singles ministry, hey. Are you good with technology? And you're thinking, I don't know, I'm just tech savvy. Honey, come and see me afterwards. We can use you in the youth. Like, I don't know how to, look, my phone's broken. So that tells you, that's not my gift. Maybe it's abused children. You want to serve with abused children. You don't know how. Where should I be serving? Ask yourself those questions. Because when you do, we can help you as a church. Your church leaders can help you get plugged in. There are many areas. Maybe you feel led to talk to recovering addicts. Maybe you're good at cleaning and organizing. And you think, yeah. Oh, see, I don't know, she's not. She's good at baking and cooking, though. She's very, I believe her gift is hospitality. I've seen that in her. But cleaning and organizing, look, yeah, and just shoot me an email. I'll be there. Like, what do you want to clean? We got this. You know, I can go to town. So where should you be serving? Listen, I want you to operate in the gifts that the Lord has given you. I want you to put them into use. I want the Lord God Almighty to use you for His story. And don't be like the servants. Don't be like those servants in the parable. You know the story in Matthew chapter 25. There was this master gave talents to three servants. All right, one got five, one got two, and one got one, right? And he gave the talents to these servants, the master did. Right? We don't know what the talents were. Maybe it was property, maybe it was a gift, whatever. But let's just say it was like a gift to them. And so I don't want you guys to leave this room and understanding that you are gifted, and be like that lazy servant that buried it and covered it up and didn't use it for God's glory or his master's benefit, or didn't even use it for his own benefit. You know, but I want you to be like those servants who brought the gift back to the master and then some. I mean, they multiplied it. They said, here, master, while you were gone, this is what I did. That is what we are called to do, women of faith. We are called to do it for his glory. So ladies, if the Lord has given you a gift, which I know he does, we see that in scripture. If he's giving you passion and vision, if he's giving you good desires in your heart, do something with it. Do something with it. Do something with it. Take time, guys, to do the spiritual assessment. Take time to ask me questions or your leaders at your home church questions. Remember, this is just a tool. I believe, I like these tools, I really do, but I believe that if you are a lady and you've already dropped to your knees and the Lord spoke to you, run with it. Don't let these tools trip you up and go, God spoke to me, but this is, it's not here. These are tools for someone to help them in their particular season. It helped me. I've done this. My husband has done this. All pastors have taken this during their pastorship, whatever they have to learn to become a pastor. And it's all good. But if the Holy Spirit can speak to you just once to confirm something, I want you to move out in faith that you are equipped to do just that. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for these ladies. Thank you, Lord, that they are seeking you, the gift giver, first and foremost. Lord, please, Lord, we know that you have equipped us and created us to be helpful. You know, you created us for Adam, Lord Jesus, and it's in our nature to be helpful, Lord, and we can do probably a lot of things that you want us to do, but we want laser focus, Lord Jesus. We want purpose. We are determined, Father God, to hear from you, Holy Spirit, to direct our paths and to give us the desires that come from your heart, Lord Jesus. I pray that these women will understand their gifts, their talents, their purpose, and that they will step out in faith using them for your glory and to help others around them in their families, homes, their neighbors, their community, their work, Lord, and of course, the body of Christ in their local churches. Thank you for them. Bless each and every one of them. You see their prayers that are on their hearts, the burdens that they brought in today, Father. May they leave here victorious and empowered by your holy presence. And it's in Jesus' name we believe and we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, ladies. I appreciate it.